I don't believe anyone should be forced into any sect, because Islam comes from your heart. So, you know, depending on how that person's been guided to Islam, it's gonna be different for each person. But for me, I got my guidance from reading the Quran. No one told me anything.
Some people are really put off by it, and I even know people who start to come into the mosque and they become a Muslim and then they just leave.
I would say try and really feel the vibration of the words which you chant every day. Because if you're really wishing Assalamu Alaikum, you're saying you're wishing peace of the divine to you, and that peace goes to everyone.
I was already aware of, like, you know, Sunni Islam and Shia Islam and Sufi Islam. I was aware of these different branches because I suppose just in general, you know, if you're kind of a modern, semi-well-learned person, you kind of have a slight awareness of the things that are going on around you.
هناك فئة واسعة اليوم في الغرب تحتنق الإسلام بعد قراءة وبعد مطالعة وبعد تعرف على المصادر وبعد يعني فهم للفكرة. هذه ربما ما كانت موجودة قبل 30 أو 40 سنة، أولاً لعدم وجود الكتابات والأدبيات الإسلامية باللغات الغربية الكافية.
I think it came from around the time of, you know, the 9/11 and these terrorist attacks, when people tried to associate Islam with terrorism, I knew that something about it wasn't right, because I come from an Irish family. I knew that historically a lot of Irish people have been associated with terrorism and the IRA, so I knew that things weren't true. So the long short of it, I started to realise, I started to read into things and see what this was about, and I ended up becoming Muslim.
I didn't really notice Muslim people until the 9/11. Like, they didn't bother me. I didn't notice them. They never got in my way. I never got in their way. But because of that experience and the way I felt scared of them, when I got back to London, I just was watching them. And I was watching other people. How do other people treat them? And I was just seeing, like, no one wants to sit next to them on the bus. And then I had one Muslim friend where we worked together, and she was quite drawn to me, and I just think I just started asking small questions, and then before I knew it, I was learning about Islam, like it was being implemented like in my daily life, but I didn't know. Like, and then my brother took his Shahada, and I was like, no way, you've become Muslim. And he was like, yeah. And I was still like, no way. But at this time I was learning about it, but I didn't even know I was learning about it.
دخل عندنا الحمد لله بعض المسلمين الذي رأيته أنهم ينقسمون إلى أقسام. منهم من يدخل في الإسلام طلبا لملء فراغ وشغور روحي عنده، فهو يعيش في حالة الفراغ، وقد يكون غنيا وقد يكون في درجة عالية من الثقافة والعلم والتحصيل العلمي والوظيفي إلى غير ذلك، إنما هو يعيش أو هي تعيش في فراغ روحي، فهم يبحثون عن ما يملأ هذا الفراغ، فيتعرفون على الإسلام ويجدون فيه طلبتهم، يعني يقبلون ويقبلون على الإسلام، الحمد لله. والغريب في الأمر أن إقبالهم يعني فيه الإخلاص العالي.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، وأشهد أن محمداً رسول الله
صلى الله عليه وسلم. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
I wasn't aware of like different groups within Islam like before, except from what you read in school. Like there are Shia Muslims and Sunni Muslims and or maybe some other groups. But then I think a lot of people when they come into Islam, they get a very romantic idea that everyone is just loving each other and everything is like a dance on roses. And
but I wasn't aware about Shia and Sunni, and I didn't really know much about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I still don't really know very much about him, but maybe a little bit more. So when I took Shahada in Bayat, then I was aware that it was the Naqshbandiya Tariqa that was the source of this mysterious circumstances that brought me to Islam. And then coming to the mosque and coming to Zikr, and then just hearing a little bit more about this, you know, the Sunnis and the Shia, and there's actually so many different conflicting ideas and theologies and scholars and sheikhs who say many different things.
دخول الإسلام ليس مرتبطا بمذهب لأن الإسلام أكبر من أي مذهب. فأن نفرض على الداخل في الإسلام أن يكون منتميا لمذهب هذا ليس من الإسلام. ولكن في واقع الحال الذي يتعرف على الإسلام بطبيعة الوضع يكون المجموعة التي عرضت له الإسلام وعرفته بالإسلام تكون منتمية لمذهب معين، لطائفة معينة، قد يكون لحزب معين، فهو ينتمي لما ينتمون إليه. وقد يظن أحيانا أنه من شروط دخول الإسلام أن يكون منتميا لهذه طائفة وهو ليس كذلك. الله أكبر. الله
أكبر. هذا الإنسان خرج من بوتقة هو شعر فيها بنوع من الاختلال النفسي ونوع من الفراغ، وجد في الإسلام كدين، كثقافة، كفكر، كدين، كروح، وجد فيه ملء لذلك الفراغ. فنحن نقوم بعد ذلك بكسر يعني هذه الحالة، النظرة المثالية لهذا الدين الجديد، نعمل على كسر هذه النظرة بفرض يعني حالة من الحالات، أنك بعد أن اعتنقت الإسلام وانضويت تحت راية هذه الأمة الواسعة التي أراد هذا الشخص أن يفعل، بعد ذلك يجب أن تختار في أي سياق أنت. هل أنت سني أم شيعي؟ ربما البعض ينزل عند مستوى المذهب، هل أنت حنفي أم شافعي أم جعفري أم غير ذلك؟ ويعني وهذه الحقيقة من المسائل المؤسفة جدا، وهذه يعني كما تفضلت لا ليس لها أي صلة لا بالواقع النفسي ولا بالواقع الشخصي ولا بالواقع الثقافي للمجتمع وللبيئة التي خرج منها هذا الإنسان.
So as a revert, I know there are some groups who go to the extreme and they actually cut off other people I would consider Muslim from Islam. In other words, they say that such and such people who do such and such things like follow Sufi tariqa or who go to dhikr circles, these kind of things, they say they're not part of Islam. And that feels to me like extremism. It's an extreme reaction to what seems to me to be a good thing. You know, people are making remembrance of Allah.
I don't feel anything about any other sect, any other race, any other religion. I just believe in my heart, like Allah guided me to Islam. I didn't choose Islam. I never thought I would even be a Muslim in a million years. Like at the time I had my call-in was in a rave. I was in a club, you know, getting into a fight, and I could have lost my life in the club. And at that moment I had my call-in. So I just think, you know, Allah guides who He wills, and you should just practice peace and, you know, do your prayers and do what you know is right. And hopefully everything else will fall into place.
In the early stages looking into Islam, the divide or the different sects within Islam, it didn't really affect me. I think also because I kind of saw Islam by myself. I wasn't like, I didn't have like one group saying, don't speak to the Shi'as, you know, they are like evil, or don't the Sufis. Like, people would say things like, I remember I was in a car with some sisters and we drove past the Sufi mosque and she was like, whatever you do, never go to that mosque, you know. A few years ago, I went to that mosque and I was like, oh yeah, the sister told me not to go here. But I'm here. The leaders in this world need therapy. You can't blame them, puppets working for free. Bring love and peace in a society. And the change gotta start inside you and me. Eternity.
For a lot of people, maybe I wouldn't even start talking to them about Islam, because I've met a lot of people who are maybe very saying, oh, you Sufis, you're wrong, because, you know, you play a drum and you're dancing and you're doing these things. This is not the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And then other people would say, no, this is a real sunnah, because actually this is the Naqshbandiya, the golden train from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And so there's so many different conflicting evidences and people always talking about this. And yeah, I'm not into that, to be honest with you, but...
الصوفية يعني هي مسألة أو تعبير اختلف في تفسيره حتى عند الصوفية أنفسهم. فإذا كانت الصوفية تعني مرتبة الإحسان في الإسلام فكلنا صوفيون، إنما إذا كانت الصوفية تعني حلقات ذكر يقفز فيها الناس، أو حلقات تدور فيها الموسيقى، أو حلقات يكون فيها اختلاط الرجال بالنساء، هذا ليس من الإسلام، دعك من الصوفية في شيء. فاختلطت الأمور أحياناً وتغيرت المسميات، إنما المضمون نحن يعنينا المضمون. Disturbed by the leaders reading papers with agendas. Don't even read but to say they don't know what I am on. But you're gonna know by the end of this poem. They don't know what I am on. Pero sí, en la fin de mi canción. They say that my faith is misogynistic, enslaving me. What do you think? I'll allow that, please. I represent for the people. Debate ended. Trying to say that I'm oppressed. Do a bloody look it.
So Rumi's Cave is a community space that is part of a charity called All for Aid. And All for Aid is a charity that was founded by a beautiful, wonderful man called Sheikh Babikir from Sudan. And he had this idea of a space that people could come to for various reasons. And he gave me the job to run this place. So I'm the project manager of Rumi's Cave. And, you know, alhamdulillah, he's really given me free rein to kind of more or less do what I want to do. So what you saw today was a poetry evening that we run. It's a monthly poetry night called Live Lounge. And for me, this is one of my favorite events for many reasons. First of all, is because we have an open mic. And what the open mic is a space where people can just come and express themselves from... Like, you never know who's going to be on the open mic.
المجتمع المحلي يعني الغربي بشكل عام لا يقبل هذه الكسور وهذه الانقسامات كحالة دائمة، ولذلك هذا الشخص الذي المنضوي تحت الإسلام مجددا إما أن يصل إلى نهاية الخط، إلى مفترق طرق، ينبغي عليه أن يختار إما أن يبقى في ضمن هذا الدين أو أن يعود إلى شيء هو على الأقل متوائم معه، أو أن يتعنت وأن يتطرف. وهذا الذي نجده للأسف الشديد ظاهراً وبارزاً في أعداد ليست بالقليلة من المسلمين الجدد.
سمعت من دخل في الإسلام وخرج، وغالب هذه الروايات أستطيع أن أفهم هذه الروايات والحالات إذا شئت. التنفير هو الذي يدعو هؤلاء الناس لترك الإسلام، وعدم التدرج في تطبيق الأحكام مع المسلمين الجدد أيضا، حتى مع المسلمين العاديين يا أخي، ليس الجدد، الذين ولدوا في الإسلام، إن أرادوا أن يلتزموا الإسلام كلا يعني صعب عليهم. إن لم يتعودوا على الصلاة والصيام والالتزام بالحلال والحرام يعني في يوم واحد أو في يوم وليلة، صعب. فكيف بالمسلم الجديد؟ في بعض الأخوات حتى إنها يعني تركت الإسلام بالكلية وانحرفت.
People that did put me off, some people did put me off was people who claimed to be a Salafiyah. That's quite putting off, because they would say that we are the only the right ones and everyone else is wrong. I mean, I still accept them as a legitimate group in their own right, but, you know, you meet a lot of people who would say, you know, don't go to this group, don't go to that group. But I'd often find that the people who said, find your own way, they were normally the ones on the truth.
يفضلون نشر دين الله سبحانه على الصلاة في مسجد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولو أنهم لم يفعلوا ذاك لما وصل دين الله إلى بقاع الأرض كلها.
والله الأسلوب المناسب لغير المسلمين وللمسلمين هو هدي النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام عندما كان يبعث الدعاة لتبليغ الرسالة عنه صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يقول لهم عليه الصلاة والسلام بشروا ولا تنفروا يسروا ولا تعسروا فهذا هو العنوان العريض الذي تنطلق منه الدعاة في تبليغ رسالة الله سبحانه وتعالى إنما الذين يعسرون والذين ينفرون هم ليسوا متبعين لهديه عليه الصلاة والسلام.
Well, it seems that nearly every group have that, and that isn't necessarily a bad thing because it means that you're strong in your faith and your love, and so it's another thing to be able to also be able to accept that, and yet maybe not. In a way, if I feel strong in where I am, I can accept other people's opinions, and I can also feel the love and feel that devotion and not feel duality.
There was actually an Egyptian preacher and missionary, an Arab, and he was a student of mine in Swedish language, and he converted into Islam because he had a dream that he was falling from a cliff or something, saying, "Oh, Jesus, help me!" And then nothing happened, and he said, "La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah," and he was saved. And after a while, he became Muslim and started to read the Quran and crying. And but then he was just put off by Muslims who were kind of like harsh towards him. I gave him a mushaf, and he was really happy about it. "Oh, my mushaf." And he put it on the floor in the mosque, and somebody came up to him and like really told him off. So he was like, what's up with these people? And I mean,
peace be upon Rasulullah, peace be upon Habibullah, peace be upon Muhammad, peace be upon Shafi'Allah, peace be upon Khair Khalilah, peace be upon Muhammad.
اليوم حينما يقال الدين اللادينيون يقولون يشيرون إلى العراق ويشيرون إلى سوريا يقولون هذا الذي تريدون هذا هو المشروع لا نرفض الدين فللأسف ينبغي على هؤلاء أن يعتبروا بأنهم ينفرون العالم عن الدين ليس فقط عن الإسلام عن الدين ويدفعونهم إلى اللادين.
I feel that the situation in Syria is very tragical because I've got very strong bonds to it because I studied there and I've got a lot of I studied with my sheikh there and the chaos that is going on now. It's very, very sad. And all over in a lot of places in the Muslim world.
Muslims fighting Muslims, obviously to any Muslim this will be sad, but like I said before, Allah knows best. I don't have the answers. Obviously, it's not nice. Yeah, people, innocent people are dying. But I'm no one to say if it's right, because at the end of the day, they're doing what they believe to be right. You know, I don't have any hate, not even for Jewish people, because what they believe that to be right. So I try not to waste too much energy in being upset and following such things that they put on the news, to be honest.
It's very sad that Muslims are fighting Muslims. I mean, this is the game where no one wins. Everyone is a loser. When people are fighting for not for justice, not for truth, but really just over a confusing thing, then that's obviously no one is winning from that. If people are realizing that no one's winning, then why are they taking part? You might as well just drop your swords, drop your weapons, and you're better off for it.
If you ask me who my God is, on whose name I call, if you ask me who my God is, he's the God of us all, Allah the Merciful.
Islam doesn't belong to the Arabs, it belongs to everybody. We've just got, just as from Indonesia to Sudan, to from the Caucasus, white people of the Caucasus Mountains to me, you know, people, Irish people. Islam belongs to everyone, and we have to remember that. And speaking Arabic is, Araba just means to state clearly. Just because you're born with the Arabic tongue doesn't give you any special right. In fact, it probably gives you more responsibility with Islam. So you have to be very patient with people.
Because to be honest with you, before I started in meditation, it didn't surprise me really, because in human beings, they always seem to make something, take something beautiful and make something horrible out of it, you know, because we have our mental weaknesses and our ego wants to hold on to something and say, no, we're right and we're right. And through being with many different groups, and one of the things that you do end up having to accept with nearly every group is that they think they're the best.
Thankfully, I haven't been in that situation myself, but I can imagine that it is, a torment in their heart. You know, it's a dilemma. In other words, they've got two ideas, and they don't really know which one is the right one. Of course, it's going to tear them apart.
That experience, new Muslims coming, just take them as they are. Just remember that Islam comes from your heart, and only Allah knows your heart. And maybe understand that it's difficult for them. You know, they come from a family that has never taught them anything about Islam. They're coming from a family that maybe is scared of Islam and Muslims, and they do need a lot of support and a lot of, encouragement in staying on the right path.
We don't strive to know Allah, really. You know, we don't strive to really have a relationship with Allah so that we're always in His presence. You know, we see Allah as over there, and we see the Quran as a book of rules, and it's a law, you know, as opposed to like a beautiful conversation that our Creator is having with us every time we open the book. Allah is speaking directly to us. You know, we don't see it like that. We just see it as a way, I don't know, we have a bad relationship with the most simplest of things. So obviously the big things would be a problem if we don't even know the basics. So that's what I would say.